OCN, Open Door Communication Network. Our frequency. Watch us live stream 24 hours. OCN, giving the voice of the Lord.
All right, via out there, good evening, wherever you are over the world. If you are in America, in California, Los Angeles, it is evening. If you are in Africa, it is morning. I bring greetings to you all. This is your regular program with Apostle Solomon Emeka Okorie, the Preachers Forum. But today I'm alone. I'm going to be talking to you on a topic I found so interesting that you need to listen to. And today I'll be talking on what I called after your message, what next? What happens after your message? Now, I'm going to look at the Bible, at the book of John, chapter 6, verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art Christ, the Son of the living God. Matthew chapter 7, verse 28. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended this saying, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Listen to me. When Jesus finished preaching, what happens? People became sober. After your message, after you preach the word, those people, your listeners, do they become sober? Do they go home thinking about the word? Or they go home excited that you've entertained them? Now, after Jesus, whenever Jesus finished preaching the word, people became sober. Some will burst into tears and ask for mercy. Does it happen in your ministry? As a pastor, does that happen in your ministry? That after your message, in a Sunday, people go home, you know, they'll become sober, they'll burst into tears and ask God for mercy. Some see the messages as too tough or hard. Some say he is talking to them. That's after Jesus finished talking. Some people will say, his message was tough. He was talking to me. They go into tears and they start crying. Does that happen to you as a man of God? Does that happen in your ministry? Or do you just entertain people? Or you are just a motivational speaker? Who are you? Your message supposed to change lives. Your message supposed to change your listeners. If you are a preacher, if you are the one preaching to people, your message is supposed to transform their lives. That's what the Bible is all about. And that's what Jesus, because he is our master, that's the principle. That's what he has laid down for each and every one of us. After Jesus finished preaching, some left the church because the message is too hard. Some repented quickly. Some say he's talking to them. Some repented quickly. Now, a greedy man will take a step to return when he has stolen. All what he has stolen, he will return it. You don't need to tell them to do restitution. Your message will be the one that is going to do it through the help of the Holy Spirit to convince your listeners. Today, does that happen in your ministry? If it's not happening in your ministry, my brother, my sister, you need to go back and think and ask Jesus to help you in your ministry. whenever some pastors of this generation finish preaching, look at, in this generation now, when we finish preaching, people become excited. Oh, they begin to hail you. They begin to say, oh my God, pastor, preach on. Some will blow whistles to say, oh my God, pastor, you are doing it. Some say, right on, pastor, give us more. Harlot is not convinced of the same. Liars continue to lie. The one who loves money see pastor as a friend. It's not supposed to be like that. 419 will continue in their 419. Our message is today supposed to transform lives. Our message is supposed to be heaven consciousness. Tell people about heaven and hell. That heaven is real and hell is real. That's what our message is supposed to do. My brother, my sister, you see, that's the one who loves money will see pastor. Oh, my pastor. Oh, kudos to you. They say, top up. You know, high five, pastor. That's not supposed to be. Your message is supposed to transform lives. You know, the one who brought girlfriend or boyfriend at home, you know, will feel comfortable and relaxed and will even be kissing because your message did not touch them. I'm not saying you should condemn them. I'm not saying you should say, repent or you die. I'm saying it is the word of God you preach that brings the conviction. You don't need to entertain them for them to come and laugh. And it becomes a theater where people come and be entertained. I tell you the truth, my brother, my sister. Today, think about this. You know, those politicians come to your church, go home, and change their ways. And know that why they are in the position where they are is to transform life, is for service. And not after listening to you, they go and steal money and come to pay tithe and come and sow seed. That's not it, my brothers. We need to think about that. Are you a pastor? Are you preaching and politician does not change? Rather, they see you as, oh, one of those pastors. Oh, my brother, that's not Christ. When Christ finished preaching, so many people left. And he turned to the 12 and said, will you also go? And Peter said, where are we going to? You are the one that have the eternal life. My brethren, we need to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We need to look unto him. He is the one that will tell us what we are doing. That's how it's supposed to be. The man who beaten his wife still go ahead to divorce her. You can imagine, after your message, somebody will still beat the wife and go ahead and divorce the wife. That's not supposed to be. It's not supposed to be like that. Your word, your message, supposed to transform them. You know, that's what I'm talking about. Young girls keep committing abortion. Today, it's no longer a crime. You see, after listening to your message, young girls still go out there and still commit abortion. It's not supposed to be. It's not at all. It's not supposed to be like that, my brother. You know, those who love the word the more. Today, you know, people talk about churches everywhere, like in Africa, in Nigeria, where I come from, people talk about, oh, everyone poor, you get a church, everyone poor, you get a church. But they don't complain when everyone poor, you have a hotel, everyone poor, you have a disco hall, you have a nightclub, you know, they don't complain about that. No, because when we preach and convince these people, they understand the importance of going to heaven. People are not conscious of heaven today because we, the preachers, are not doing enough to convince them there's a place called heaven. They see church as a theater. They see church today as a place of entertainment. It's not supposed to be. It's not. God has called us to preach the word. And when they hear the word, the Bible says that the word of God is a light unto our faith. You know, so when the light shines, darkness will disappear. So when there's darkness inside of them, when the word of God comes in, it will eliminate it. It's going to bring light. That's how it's supposed to be. Not to remain in our sins. Not to be hardened the more. But to change us and transform us. That's regeneration. Reformation. When the word of God comes in, that's what it does. You know? So those who dress like harlot became worse after seeing pastor's wife dressed like Delilah. I'm not saying you should dress like Egyptian mummy, but more dread. You know, there's the Bible says in the book of Proverbs, it says there's a dress that looks like a harlot. There are people who dress, it doesn't matter. But I want to tell you, decency is what Christ is teaching us. I'm not condemning you, whether you wear trousers or not. I'm not here to talk about that. But decent dressing. There are bad trousers. There are bad skirts. That's the truth. But you dress as a child of God. That's something that's going to win people to Christ. But I want to tell you something. As a preacher, do you preach to convince people? Or do you preach for people to get excited? For people to get entertained? Of course, you know today, in our churches, we invite, I'm sorry to say this on air, but that's the truth. It's happening. People invite comedians to come to church. They say, people are suffering today. They're going to get rid of high blood pressure. They're going to get rid of depressions by bringing a comedian to church. Listen to me. I want to tell you something. Anything the Word of God cannot change, anything the Word of God cannot heal, I don't think it's comedy that will heal it. That's a temporary solution you're bringing to them. They laugh and laugh and laugh and go. And they still remain in their problem. They still remain in their sins. It's not good enough. My brother, my sister, it's not good enough. Let's preach the word. The Bible said in the book of John chapter 1, in the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word itself was God. So whenever the word of God comes, the word of God is supposed to press, break things. That is not supposed to be. Today, why have you come to think of this? Have you asked yourself why we don't have miracles again in the church? Have you asked of that? And that's why you see charlatans go out there looking for solution. Native doctors have changed their clothes in the name of prophets. They answer prophets today. And they prophesy lies when God have not spoken. It's not supposed to be. Because we are not preaching the word. You, do you preach the word to change these people? Because you are like a watchman. Oh, you are a watchman in the book of Ezekiel 33. The Bible says you are a watchman. You are watching over the flocks. And if you don't tell them the truth, if anything happens to those flocks in your church, God will require their blood in your hand. I know, my brother, pastor, evangelist, apostle, bishop, archbishop, I know you wouldn't want God to require the blood of your members in your hand. You need to preach the word to them. You need to preach a word that will convince a sinner. It's not, you know, condemnation, repent or you die, no. Preach the word of God. The word of God will be the one that will convince them. People still go to church today and they smoke. They say it doesn't matter. Did you see smoking in the Bible? It doesn't matter. People go to church today and they still live in alcoholism. They drink alcohol. They say it doesn't matter. After my pastor drinks, chop knuckle, pastor. I will drink it. And pastor say it doesn't matter. They will quote a scripture for you in the book of Timothy. Apostle Paul said, Timothy, take a little for your stomach. Some will tell you, Jesus turned water into wine. That means he asking us to drink. And you don't see anything bad in it. My brother, I want to tell you the truth. Read the word of God. You are a king. You are a prince. You are a princess. Have you read the scripture that said you should not give a strong drink, alcohol, to a king, in order not to pervert justice? That's to say, you as a king, you're not supposed to be in alcohol. This is the kind of messages we're supposed to dish out on Sundays, and sinners will repent. Brethren, I want to tell you, you know, there's a song, Goodbye World, I stay no longer with you. Goodbye pleasures of sin, I stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to do this way. You know, I've made up my mind to follow God all the rest of my life. Have you made up your mind? Have you made up your mind? Preacher, have you made up your mind to preach and take people to heaven? Very, very important. We need to do that. I'm going to read another scripture to you now, because I want you to understand that the word of God, God is going to ask you as a preacher about these people. If you don't repent, if you don't stop entertaining people in the church, God is going to require the blood in your hand. And I know that you will repent first as a preacher. That's why we're having preachers forum. That's the essence of preachers forum. For you to know that you are called to win souls and depopulate the kingdom of darkness and populate the kingdom of God. Jesus is all about love. Jesus is all about love. Okay, now we are in the season of Christmas. So many people will come to your church during the new year. Crossover service. We target so many things. Crossing over. Exodus. There are so many tasks that will be given to this crossover now. And people will come that at that first night. People will fill in our churches. Everywhere will be filled up. Because they come to church on 31st to come and say, "Hi, God, I'm here. You know, I'm going to make a decision. 2017, I'm not going to smoke again. 2017, I'm not going to drink again. 2017, I'm not going to lie. 2017, I'm not going to steal. 2017, I'm not going to cheat. 2017, a lot of things they will dish out after January. Second, third, they go back. And you, pastor, you don't preach to them to remind them all they have said. God will require these people's blood in our hands as pastors. That's why it's important we tell these people the truth. That's why it's important you understand the mind of Christ. And when we say that Jesus is love, he is love. He will preach with love. But after preaching, these people will come back and get born again. And now, I want us to read the book of Matthew. Let's see. Verse 23. It said, "Behold, the virgin shall be with a child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," meaning God with us. A preacher, tell the people that God is with them. Whatever they are doing, so many people don't know. They think, oh, when they see you as a pastor, they pretend and all is well. But outside the pastor, they don't know that God is with them. We need to tell people that heaven is real and hell is real. My brother, my sister, you need to tell them. Jesus preached. And people left. He turned and asked his disciples, "Will you also go?" Why did he do that? Some of us are looking for number. Some of us are looking for, how big is your church? What is the population of your church? None of us are asking, how many people are we taking to heaven? They don't care. What they want to do, they want to build an empire. It doesn't matter how the money comes. You want to build an empire here. But this is a temporary place. You know, there's a place. Jesus says, "I've gone to prepare a place for you." Is Jesus preparing that house for you? Ask the preacher. I'm asking you. Is Jesus preparing a place for you and you take people home? Or do you just want to build an earthly empire here? After building the empire, and that's all. And God will say, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I know you not." Would that be your portion, a preacher? I know. I'm asking you, my brother. I'm asking you, my sister, the fellow servant of God. I'm asking you, please, that would not be your portion. Do you know that the devil will laugh at you? Seriously. We'll ask you, "Oh, you later came here because you've been telling people, entertaining them. Oh, have you read the Bible? Let me show you. In the book of Psalms, Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. I want to show you something in the book of Psalms. Psalm chapter 1. Psalm chapter 1. The book of, yes, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This, I'm so excited because I know that I want you to understand today. Psalm 24. Okay, Psalm 1 from verse 1. The Bible said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the wicked, nor standeth in the ways of sinners. So there are ways that are for sinners. Do you tell your people like that? Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the wicked, nor standeth in the ways of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scoffers. You know who are the scoffers? The jesters. Ask yourself, do you tell your people like that? You bring entertainers to come to the church. He said, but his delight is in the word of the Lord, in the law of Jehovah. That should be our delight. How many people in your church today? I wonder when you see so many people today say, I'm born again. They don't know a scripture. They can't quote a scripture. But they are in a Bible-believing church because pastor does not read Bible again. When he comes to the church, he brings out how to make money. That's what he's going to teach. Financial integrity. This one, the other one. Yes, it is good to have that. But the Bible teaches them the basis. The word of God first. All these things will come. When the word of God, the fear of God is in them, all these things will be in place. That's why the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. We need to seek the kingdom of God first. Tell your members to seek the kingdom of God first. Good wife will be added. Money will be added. Whatever they are looking for will be added unto them. But you need to let them know the word of God. I tell you the truth, my brothers. God is expecting all this from us. You know, look at that. He says in verse 2, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Did you get that? He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. First of all, if he walks in the word, in the law, you know, some people today are talking about grace, law. Yes, Christ has come. He brought grace. But do we continue in sin that grace may abound? You say, God forbid. We should not continue, you know, in all this, it doesn't matter of a thing. We need to know that we should walk with the fear of God. When he's talking now, he said, walking in the word. When the word of God is in you, you have the fear of God. And when the fear of God is in you, there are things you will not do. Yes. There are things you will not cheat. You will not commit fornication or adultery. Yes. When the word of God is richly dwelling in you, it is light. It will eliminate all the darkness in you. That's why it says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the wicked. Now let's go there. He said, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit. Now, when you have the fear of God, child of God, if you have the fear of God, you bring out your fruit. What are your fruits? Manifestation of God's goodness. You bring it out. People will see that the Lord is good in you. In your life, your life will reflect God's goodness. You don't struggle. Yes, you don't struggle. You need to tell your people that. Preacher, tell them that they need God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, that every other thing shall be added unto them. These are the messages we need to preach to our people for them to understand. It's not coming to church on Sunday and our lives still remain the same. It's not coming to church on Sunday, we're still living the same way we're living. Healings, you know, are no longer taking place today. Because when the word of God comes, it breaks those yokes. Okay, now, Isaiah, It says, it shall come to pass in that day that every burden shall be lifted up from our shoulders, every yoke from our neck. He said, by the reason of anointing. Anointing is the word of God. When the word of God comes up, he says, by the reason of the anointing, that every yoke shall be broken. What are the yokes? Sickness is a yoke. When the anointing comes upon them, sickness will be broken. Poverty will be broken. All these things delay. Now, you know, today we have special services for deliverance. They call deliverance service, they call this, they call that, they call the other one. But do you know, people pay special money to consult a pastor and they give them tags and say, okay, you are number 10. So that the pastor will teach your people, when they know the word, they can pray and God will answer their prayers. So many of us are afraid that if our people know the word, they might not remain in our churches. It's not true. Teach them the word. They will always be there. They want to stay with you because they know they are getting the real food from you. The real word. Teach them the word. Tell them they can do it on their own. Tell them they can pray and things happen. That's the truth. You should not be one demigod. People consult you. Oh, you feel happy because your people are baby all the time. They don't know the word. Teach them the word. Brother, teach them the word. Pastor, teach them the word. Prophet, teach them the word. Evangelist, teach them the word. Today, we don't know who is an evangelist. Evangelist, how many souls have you brought to the kingdom of God? You are a soul winner. And you are comfortable in the church. Dragging position and pulpit with the pastor. Go out there and go and preach the word to the people. Bring them to the church for the pastor to nurture them and pastor them. Apostle, missions. That's the truth. I tell us the truth today. If we look at all these things and the biblical principles, what Jesus have left for us, our generation will change. Have you wondered why that upon a lot of churches all over, lives are still the same? Have you thought of that? Have you thought of this, my brother, my sister? Just think about it. I want you to think about what I've said today. That we as pastors, God will hold us responsible for our members. It's very, very important. We need to understand this. And we need to know that Jesus is coming very soon. He said, I'm coming quickly with my reward to give to every man according to his worship. I want to leave you with this song, my brothers and sisters. I want to leave you with this song. Love of Jesus is wonderful. Love of Jesus is beautiful. Love of Jesus is marvelous. Oh, wonderful love. Love of Jesus is wonderful. Love of Jesus is beautiful. Love of Jesus is marvelous. Oh, wonderful love. So high, I can't get into it so deep. I can't get into it so wide. I can't get around it. Oh, wonderful love. So high, I can't get over it so deep. I can't get around it so wide. I can't get around it. Oh, wonderful love. Love of Jesus is wonderful. Love of Jesus is beautiful. Love of Jesus is marvelous. Oh, wonderful love. I tell you, love, his love is so wonderful. Come to him. Thank you so much for watching your program, The Preacher's Forum on OCN Television. Please, I want you to encourage OCN in Africa. OCN is now in Africa, in Nigeria, Imo State, Owerri Imo State. You can support OCN. See the numbers there? You call to support OCN. I want to tell you, you supporting OCN, you are taking the word of God all over the world. I want to thank the bishop, Bishop Nikki Ogamba, that God has used to establish OCN. And she is doing a great job, a job of an apostle. I tell you, taking the word of God all over the world. I tell you, please, support us. Your $10, your $20, your $5, your $100 can go a long way to make sure that the word of God is reaching to everywhere. I tell you the truth. God will bless you for service. God bless you. Thank you so much. I still remember your brother, Apostle Solomon. Thank you so much. Bye. Till see you again. God, thank you for your word that have come so far. I thank you for the pastors. I thank you because I know you are going to bless them. Lord, give them your word, that they will preach your word in season and out of season, that they will preach this word with your fear, that the listeners will get convinced that of a truth that you are God. Thank you, Father. For my listeners, may your name be glorified in their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. See you sometime next time.
OCN, Open Door Communication Network. Our frequency. Watch us live stream 24 hours. OCN, giving the voice of the Lord.